Hello there. Well, the purpose of this video is very simple. It's just to let you all know that The Reluctant Apostate is now on Amazon. This is the hard copy version, which as you can see is quite a thick book. It's slightly different from the version that I went to collect in the previous video. I don't know whether you saw my road trip across Europe, where I went to collect a batch of books for the Indiegogo campaign. Those books had a gloss cover. This has a matte cover, which was the original plan, really. And it's also slightly thicker because the index has been expanded. The list price for this book on Amazon is $29.50, but I've noticed it's already been discounted on a few occasions, so it could be that you don't have to pay that full amount. But if it sounds like the hard copy version is just a bit too expensive right now, or if you prefer reading books digitally, you'll be pleased to know that there is a Kindle version, and the Kindle version is priced at $9.99 in America. If you happen to be on the Kindle Unlimited program, I understand you'll be able to read it for free. So that's pretty much the point of this video, to make those announcements. But I thought I would take the opportunity to give a little bit more information about the book, so that you can understand what it's about, what purpose it serves, that sort of thing. So, the first few pages are obviously devoted to things like acknowledgements and contents and that kind of thing. There is a foreword by Hemant Mehta, who is my friend over at the Friendly Atheist blog. He's provided a lovely foreword just highlighting the fact that very few non-Jehovah's Witnesses really have much of a clue about the amount of damage that goes on within the religion. So I think he did a really good job at just introducing and easing that type of reader into the book. And then there's my introduction, in which I try to set out my reasons for writing the book, the reason why I've called it The Reluctant Apostate, and to just again try and set out what my aims are, identify who my readers are and what my objectives are in writing the book. Then chapter one is called How to Make a Jehovah's Witness. This chapter really deals with what's involved in becoming a Jehovah's Witness. So what's the process from meeting a Jehovah's Witness on the doorstep through to getting baptized? And it also argues that it's becoming increasingly unlikely for that to be the way new Jehovah's Witnesses get made, for want of a better word. Because in my own experience, most Jehovah's Witnesses are Jehovah's Witnesses because they were raised that way. They were raised in the religion from birth. So having explained all that, I then go into the first part of my story, which deals with my early childhood, a few occasions when my beliefs were shaped at a very formative age, and then goes right through to my baptism at the age of 11. Then chapter two is titled The Page Folding Pioneer, which I appreciate must sound like a rather cryptic title for a chapter. Essentially, the chapter is all about the preaching process and the efforts that the governing body goes to make sure witnesses are involved in preaching, preferably as pioneers. It talks all about the process of counting hours, counting time. It also goes into the issue with higher education, the way the governing body really frowns on higher education for young witnesses and points them instead in the direction of pioneering. And then we again go back to my story, and I pick up from when I first started going to high school through to my 2 years in college. And I talk about how there was this constant gravitational pull almost towards pioneering, how I became a pioneer, and how I ended up having some fairly serious doubts about the organisation, even at a quite young age as a Jehovah's Witness. Chapter three is titled God's Promise of Paradise. And in this chapter, I talk about paradise. I talk about what really is the main motivation I feel for many witnesses, which is the desire to live in this idyllic new world in which all of one's needs and wishes are miraculously cared for, and in which all of one's dead loved ones are raised from the dead, and one lives this blissful experience. So I talk about that, but I talk about it in terms of what it really entails. So I go into the real nitty-gritty of what would be required in order for that vision to become a reality. For the biographical part of that chapter, I talk about the death of my mother, which was, as you can imagine, a very distressing thing that happened to me. I was 21 years old at the time, but as you read on, you begin to understand how this experience pulled me back from my early doubts and made me absolutely resolve to do everything I could to cling as close to the organisation as possible so that I could see her again. Chapter 4 has the title Jehovah's Witnesses and Sex, which I don't think this subject gets quite enough coverage in terms of, you know, literature by former Jehovah's Witnesses, but it is something that I feel impacts on all Jehovah's Witnesses, especially the younger generation. I talk about the preoccupation in Watchtower literature over the past few decades with regulating people's sex lives, including the sex lives of married people. And then for my biographical part, I talk about the period in my life when I went to ministerial training school, and I devote a few pages to what that experience was like. But interwoven in that narrative is what it felt like to be a young man who was basically in the grips of what I now consider to be sexual repression, and what kind of impact that repression had on me as a young guy in his mid-20s. Chapter 5 is titled Shepherd the Flock, and in this chapter I basically talk about elders, and I talk about the Watchtower hierarchy and where elders fit in that hierarchy, basically where everyone fits in that hierarchy. I talk about the relationship between Watchtower and congregations. I open up the chapter with examples of two congregations, namely Bonham, Texas and Menlo Park in California, where there was essentially a standoff between the elders and Watchtower, and how those two instances very clearly showed the true nature of Watchtower as a hierarchy. For the biographical part of that chapter, I pick up my story having just got married to Deanna, who I met as a result of going to MTS, and I talk about my experiences as an elder. I spent a year as an elder, and what I saw during that year was it basically completely dashed any preconceptions I had about the organisation being a loving community and elders being appointed by Holy Spirit. I also in this chapter talk about the very unexpected string of events that led to Deanna and I moving to Croatia, me no longer being an elder, and basically being in a situation where I was in another country, no longer able to understand what was being said at meetings, and basically unplugged from my indoctrination for the first time and free to think for myself. And I take the reader through what was going on in my mind and basically my slide into apostasy. For chapters 6 through 10, I basically put my own story on hold and focus purely on the organisation and its history. So Chapter 6 is titled The Pastor, and Chapter 6 is basically about how Jehovah's Witnesses first got started in terms of Charles Taze Russell and the Bible students. Who were the early influences on Charles Taze Russell? What was his input on the organisation? How did his character and personality sculpt the organisation? And what were the controversies and scandals surrounding Charles Taze Russell that lots of Jehovah's Witnesses will be completely unfamiliar with. Then there's chapter 7, The Judge. You can imagine who this is about. This is about Joseph Franklin Rutherford, and it basically tells the story of this remarkable character. Chapter 7 is actually the longest chapter because there was so much to write about this man. And I felt I needed to do him justice because he had such a profound impact on Jehovah's Witnesses, and a lot of his personality traits and a lot of his little quirks are still manifested in the culture of Jehovah's Witnesses today. So I wanted to make sure I covered all my bases with Joseph Rutherford and talk about everything. Talk about Bethsarim, talk about the drinking, talk about the womanizing, talk about the 1925 failed prophecy, talk about the Nazis and his attempts to ingratiate himself with Hitler. I wanted everything to be covered, and hopefully I've done a decent job there. I called chapter 8 Rise of the Slave, and basically this chapter is everything after Rutherford. So it tells the story of how Watchtower transitioned from being run by a single president to being run by a governing body, or the slave, hence the name of the chapter. So we start with Nathan Knorr becoming president. We then go right through to the dispute in 1975 when it transitioned from control of, by Nathan Knorr through to control of the governing body. It explains what happened in 2012 when the governing body finally took on the mantle of the faithful and discreet slave. And it basically takes the reader through all of the main sort of scandals and controversies that have affected the organisation right up to the present. Chapter 9 is titled Blood and Tears, and that is all about blood transfusions and domestic violence. And I make the argument that the mishandling of both areas really stems from this attitude in Watchtower that service to God or service to Watchtower comes first and human life comes second. So in the case of blood transfusions, I explain where that teaching came from, some of its earliest origins, and I talk about the mechanics of it today in terms of the fractions rule and how inconsistent and incoherent the whole blood transfusions policy is. I then talk about domestic violence and give two examples of where Watchtower's fixation with the rules on adultery and keeping the sanctity of marriage have resulted in real misery and, in one case, even death. Chapter 10 is titled Suffer the Little Children. And for those of you who've seen my feature-length video titled Jehovah's Witnesses and Child Abuse, Is There a Problem? This chapter is basically, in written form, that video, but with a bit of extra information added, so I'm able to go into a little bit more detail in what the current rules are surrounding child abuse and the current policies. I explain how the policies have changed over recent years. I talk about some standout cases that really highlight the damage that Watchtower is doing and how it's failing to protect children from pedophiles. Chapter 11 is about shunning. It's titled 8 Million Hostages. And as you might guess, the reason I called it that is because I consider Jehovah's Witnesses, who number 8 million, to all essentially be hostages. Because even if they disagreed, decided they no longer wanted to be witnesses, they are held hostage, I argue, through the practice of shunning or disfellowshipping. I talk about the history of shunning, the history of disfellowshipping, and then I return to my own story and I pick up where I've realised I no longer want to be a witness and I want to do something about it. And I make the decision that I'm going to inform my father that I'm going to be leaving the witnesses. I talk about his reaction. And I talk about my apostasy trial, my judicial committee, which resulted in me no longer being a Jehovah's Witness. The final chapter, chapter 12, is titled A Prisoner No More. And in that I talk I open up by talking about cults and what I consider cults to be. I talk about mind control and the way it affects people and influences their behaviour once they get involved in cults. I talk about the way religions are treated by society in general, particularly harmful religions. I talk about my personal reasons for no longer being a believer. And in the biographical part, I talk about the process of getting back that sense of community, which I feel is important for anyone who's leaving the witnesses. You really do need to establish who is, what your new community is. So I talk about that journey and the friends that I made and the help I received after leaving the witnesses. And I won't spoil the ending for you, but a few people are saying it's quite an emotional ending. So hope you'll enjoy that. And then to conclude the book, I have a postscript, which is basically about a young man who reached out to me as I was finishing the book, who was treated appallingly by his elders. And when he reached out to me, I realised that his story and mine had a number of similarities. And I thought it was a great example to highlight what it's like, especially for young Jehovah's Witnesses who wake up nowadays in the information age, when it's getting easier and easier for people to get objective information about Jehovah's Witnesses. And I talk about that whole process and just give a few thoughts on activism in general and ways that we can do activism and reach out to Jehovah's Witnesses in productive and meaningful ways. And then after the postscript, there's a rather large appendix where I provide information that I didn't have room for in the book. I also have a notes section, and the purpose of the notes section is to give you the references for all of the parts of the book where I'm quoting from, usually from Watchtower. But my approach when writing was to just do the quickfire quotes without having to worry about saying, oh, well, this is from here and this is from there. And just think, I'm going to leave all of those references for the back of the book so that if I say something and the reader thinks, surely they didn't say that, they can just look it up in the notes section and realise that, yes, they did say that. So that's pretty much The Reluctant Apostate, a quick summary of what's involved in the chapters. I really hope that it will make a difference and help people to get a real grasp of what the religion is all about. I certainly learned a huge amount when writing it. I started writing it, as I mentioned, towards the end of 2012 and then finished just before Christmas, just this last Christmas gone. And honestly, the amount of information I uncovered and the things I learned when writing some of those chapters is just phenomenal. So I hope other people will benefit from it. So coming up at the end of this video will be a link for where you can buy the new book. I did just briefly want to mention that one or two of you in Canada are saying that the book isn't yet available on Canadian Amazon. I'm still not sure why that is. I have, from my end, I've done everything I can to make sure it is in as many countries and as many distribution channels as possible, but I am going to try and get some answers from Amazon, and if I hear anything from them, I will drop it into a comment or in the description below. But otherwise, that's about it. Thanks for bearing with me with this video. I obviously have spent a lot of time writing a book, and I'm afraid I need to plug it now and then. I just want to thank everybody who's helped me in various stages of the book. There are so many of them. And I want to give a special shout out to the hundreds of you who supported me on Indiegogo to get the book over the finish line and pay for costs and that kind of thing to make it the best possible book I could make it. So thank you, thank you, thank you. But that's it from me. If you haven't read the book yet, I hope you enjoy it. And as always, thank you for watching.